have seen repeatedly in the early church that when they came together, when they heard the word, when the Holy Spirit touched them, they praised God, they sang their praises, they gave thanks for the Lord Jesus Christ. And so tonight, as we come together as the church of 2020, let's praise God. Let's sing together, Lord, I lift your name on high.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my day to day, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my day. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
On Sunday, we saw a remarkable passage where Peter and John had gone to the temple, and again, the Holy Spirit had worked through them, and a lame man had been healed. So tonight, we pick up from where we left off in the book of Acts, again, reading from Acts chapter 3, but this time, we pick up from verse 11. Thanks to Ryan for tonight's reading.
Acts chapter 3, verses 11 to 26. Peter's message in the temple. As the man held on to Peter and John in Solomon's porch, as it was called, the people were amazed and ran to them. When Peter saw the people, he said to them, "Fellow Israelites, why are you so surprised at this? And why do you stare at us? Do you think that it was by our means of our own power or godliness that we made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has given divine glory to his servant Jesus. But you handed him over to the authorities and you rejected him in Pilate's presence, even after Pilate had decided to set him free. He was holy and good, but you rejected him. And instead, you asked Pilate to do you the favour of turning loose a murderer. You killed the one who leads to life, but God raised him from death, and we are witnesses to this. It was the power of his name that gave strength to this lame man. What you see and know was done by faith in his name. It was faith in Jesus that has made him well, as you can all see. And now, my friends, I know that what you and your leaders did to Jesus was due to your ignorance. God announced long ago through all the prophets that his Messiah had to suffer, and he made it come true in this way. Report then and turn to God, so that he will forgive your sins. If you do, times of spiritual strength will come from the Lord, and he will send Jesus, who is the Messiah. He has already chosen for you. He must remain in heaven until the time comes for all things to be made new, as God announced through his holy prophets of long ago. For Moses said, "The Lord your God will send you a prophet, just as he sent me, and he will be one of your own people. You are to obey everything that he tells you to do. Anyone who does not obey the prophet shall be separated from God's people and destroyed. And all the prophets who had a message, including Samuel and those who came after him, also announced what has been happening these days. The promises of God through his prophets are for you, and you share in the covenant which God made with your ancestors. As he said to Abraham, through your descendants I will bless all the people on earth. And so God chose his servant and sent him to you first, to bless you by making every one of you turn away from your wicked ways.
There is nothing worse than going out on a cold winter's morning and finding that your car won't start, the battery's gone flat, and you're going to need a hand, or else you're going to be stuck right where you are. And it's great if someone can come along with their car and jump leads, and the power can be provided from one battery to the other to work through it and get you going and on your road again. I say this only as an analogy because at the very start of the passage that we've read tonight, we need to understand what's going on. Obviously, the lame man who has been hanging around in the same spot for many, many years can now jump about and he can walk, and that's visible and evident for everyone who's there. And so a crowd is gathering while they're trying to work out what's going on. And Peter again steps up to the mark. We've seen him do this before. And he steps up to the mark to give an explanation. And notice that he's very keen for them to understand that it's not them. It isn't me. It's not me, Peter. It's not John. It's not us that have the power to do this. It's kind of like the guy who brings the car up. On his own, if he touches your car battery, nothing's going to happen. The power is coming from the other battery that is full of life. And what Peter's explaining is that the power is coming from the Lord Jesus Christ himself. The power is coming from God through the Holy Spirit. It's not us that have performed this mighty miracle. The glory has to go to God. The vehicle has been through the Holy Spirit of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as Peter stands there and explains everything to them, the first part of his explanation sounds a little bit like what we heard before Cafe Church at the beginning of June, when Peter's explaining to them, when he's saying to them, hey, it's the, you know, the Jesus that you had crucified. Well, what did you do? Because that's where this power is coming from. And at the beginning of June, we saw Peter use King David and the Psalms as a way of joining the dots. In tonight's passage, he joins the dots again, but this time he uses Abraham and prophets as a way of explaining who Jesus is and why they should be listening and where this power is coming from. And I think what we need to understand is that Peter is very keen for the people that are listening, and to us too, for us to understand the Old Testament as part of something much, much bigger. In this time of lockdown, I know that some of you have been digging out old jigsaw puzzles that you've done before and getting them out again just to pass some time. Jigsaw puzzles are great, providing that number one, you have all the pieces, number two, you have the picture. Because if you've got a 1,000-piece jigsaw and you don't have the picture, it's hard to even know where to start. In a sense, that's what Peter is telling us about the scriptures. And too often we make a mistake of just jumping into one book or one passage without understanding that they fit together. And Peter is trying to get us to understand that the Old Testament is kind of pointing us continually in a direction. It's pointing us to a time when God is going to complete a restoration of the world. When the world is going to be more than just restored to what it was, it's going to be renewed and even better. And what Peter is doing is he's pointing us, showing us that through the scriptures, through the Old Testament scriptures, this journey is there. And this restoration will begin with the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why he goes to great lengths to put everything into place, to get the pieces of the jigsaw fitting together so that the crowds that were there on the day, and us too, understand the bigger picture and the bigger implications. And he goes all the way back. He's talking about Moses and Moses bringing that first rescue where the people are slaves in Egypt, bringing them out to be a nation. And in a sense, he's drawing us all the way through, showing us that the Lord Jesus Christ has come to perform the ultimate rescue from the power of evil itself, so that we can be liberated not to be a nation, but to be God's people. God's people. The kingdom people, if you like. To be part of something that is worldwide, a much, much bigger picture. And what Peter does is he explains how it all fits in. He uses Moses, he talks about the prophets, he mentions Samuel. Samuel was interesting because Samuel was probably more well known for being the one who anointed the kings. And in a sense, he's talking about now King Jesus, who has fulfilled and completed Israel's history, if you like. And he also then rounds that up to the promises of Abraham, because God promised that Abraham would be the father of many nations. Through a covenant to Abraham comes a covenant of faithfulness, God's faithfulness to us, to his people then, to his people throughout the generations, and to us now. And remember, we've already been told that we are people of God's promise, of that faithfulness, of that covenant relationship. A new covenant now that has been signed and sealed by the Lord Jesus Christ. And we also need to understand that what Peter is doing is he's giving an invitation. Please don't think for one minute that he's pointing at the Jewish people standing there and saying it's your fault. Please don't think that this is a whole speech, a whole sermon where Peter is trying to apportion blame. No, it's a whole sermon where he is inviting them to recognize what they've done, to recognize just exactly where they are, and to get them to receive and accept an invitation to become God's people, to turn around and from that point onwards to be the people that God is calling them to be, kingdom people, renewed and restored right now. Peter points out that Jesus, who has already been through this restoration, that Jesus is going to be in heaven now until such time as that new creation, that restoration is complete. Until that time when heaven and earth are very much one. That they've come together. We've already talked about them being dimensions that overlap. But when the time comes for us to be one big dimension, is the time where God restores and finishes his new creation. And Jesus will come back at that point. And we are being invited, just as they were then, to be part of that new creation. The new creation for us starts right now, in our own individual lives as individuals. The new creation for the world will be completed at a time when God decides. But for now, that invitation is for every single one of us to be part of God's covenant promise, to be part of that hope that he has brought into the world, to understand that the Holy Spirit has been given for all times, to continue the work that has been pointed to all the way through Scripture and continues right now in the here and now in the present times. We might think that times are tough right now, and they are. We're also looking for towards better times, towards it getting better. Ultimately, we're looking towards a much, much better time when God's new creation is complete. But for us, that better time starts right now, no matter what the future holds, because God will be our strength through the power of the Holy Spirit. So let's talk to God right now. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for your promises. Every promise that you have made, you have upheld. We thank you for the promise to Abraham. We thank you for your covenant promise. We thank you that that promise extends to everyone, that we would all know your forgiveness and be brought into the fullness of life through the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, as we start to look towards the future, still a little bit uncertain as what the future holds, may we recognize that you are our future, and that you hold our future in your hands. Maybe hold that, and may that promise give us the strength and the refuge that we need to face every single day. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And let us close with a reminder that God is our strength and refuge. So now may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you evermore. Amen.